Well, if you brought your Bibles with you this morning, you might want to go ahead and find the New Testament book of Ephesians, and we're looking at chapter 4 this morning, Ephesians chapter 4. As you're finding that in your Bible, I just want to say that Connie and I continue to be blessed by you. We are so blessed by your love and your acceptance and your encouragement that you keep lavishing on us week after week, and we are just so encouraged by that, and we continue to be grateful for you. We continue to pray that the Holy Spirit will bind us together in a mission and vision that will bring God much glory and benefit many people with His grace. That is our greatest desire. Now, to be clear, I just want to make sure that I keep you reminded for now that I'm still in the mode in which I am speaking to you from my heart. I'm not finished yet. I got some things that I want to say more, and just kind of explaining how God has been shaping my thinking about ministry and how I intend to lead wherever God plants me to serve. And it goes back to these two things. First, a mission. We're going to put it on the screen. I want you to read this mission with me aloud, if you would, please. Love God by loving others, leading them to become fully functioning followers of Jesus Christ. That's the foundation. That's the mission. Then there's a vision that goes along with that. Read that with me if you would. To establish a growing body of believers in Des Moines, Iowa, who embrace and live out the gospel of Jesus Christ to the end of making healthy, maturing followers of Christ across generational, gender, and racial lines. For me, as I, at almost the age of 57, look out to the age of 70 as a benchmark, I find that this mission and vision is my bigger yes. It is that which I believe God has called me to focus my time and talent and treasure toward over the next 13 years. I might not make it 13 years. I may make it another 25 years. I don't know, but just kind of looking at that as a general benchmark, this is what I believe God has called me to do. And I tell you, I feel so much freedom now that that has been settled in my heart. And no matter what somebody else is doing or not doing, that's all well and good. But for me, this is how God has called me to serve and to minister and to lead, and by His grace, I'm going to do that. Now, if today is your first Sunday back with us, or just your first Sunday ever with us here since my sabbatical ended on March 5th, and you'd like to have more details about that mission and vision statement, I did two sermons on that, and you can access both the audio and video on our website, which is there on the screen, firstfederated.org. You find the menu tab, the media tab, and then those messages were done on March the 12th and 19th, respectively. Today, the title of the message is Health is Key. Health is key. And the central thought of this message, if you picked up a note guide on your way in, you'll find that it's right there in a box in the center. The central thought of today's message is that spiritual health, Christian maturity, is God's design for every person upon whom He pours out saving grace. Spiritual health, Christian maturity, it is God's design for every person upon whom He pours out saving grace. In the time that I have here this morning, I want to expose you to this central thought. And I want to expose you to it because I want you to have a biblical frame of reference as to why spiritual health and Christian maturity will play such a big role in my ministry, our ministry, I hope, as we move forward together. Taking the points of today's message from Ephesians chapter 4, let's take a look at the passage. See what it has to say, and then we'll begin to break it down. We begin with verse 7, where it says, however he, and I stop with he to tell you that the he there is the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:7 would help us clear that up if you're studying it out. However he has given each of us, I have to stop again. The us there is a reference to those who are followers of Christ. He has given us a special gift. I won't be doing this the whole sermon, but I stop again to make sure you understand that when he says he gives us a special gift, it's not like a birthday gift or a Christmas gift, all right? It's you might want to think of it as a spiritual ability, a supernatural ability to engage in the work of God in a special way. All right, let's start over. However, the Holy Spirit has given each of us followers of Christ a special ability through the generosity of Christ. That is why the scriptures say, and this what is about to be said is a reference back to Psalm 68:18. When he ascended to the heights, he led a crowd of captives and gave gifts to his people. Notice that it says he ascended. This clearly means that Christ also descended to our lowly world. And the same one who descended is the one who ascended higher than all the heavens so that he, that is Christ, might fill the entire universe with himself. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to his church. Now by the way, the Holy Spirit gives us individual believers certain gifts, but Christ has given his church as a big body, certain gifts. And here are those specific gifts. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing up in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly as each part does its own special work. It helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. And Father, I pray from the reading of your word that your Spirit now will speak to our hearts as we break this down. May the things that are declared be accurate according to the intention of your Spirit as he inspired Paul to write these words. May we find then application in our lives, both individually as your followers, as your sons and daughters, and may we find an application corporately as one of the expressions of your local church in this community. Father, dry bones. We've all been there. There's been a time, I think, when we would say we've been just dry bones, but may your Spirit blow the wind of life over us, and may we come together, and may we stand up as a healthy, marching army of the Lord Jesus Christ, accomplishing great things for your name's sake, for your kingdom, in the power of your love, and the greatness of your mercy and grace. If that's to happen, it will require that special wind of the Spirit. May it blow even now, I pray, in Jesus' name. This whole passage that I just read to you is about spiritual health, which leads to Christian maturity and growth. I believe even the most casual reading of the passage reveals the expectation that God has for his children to be spiritually healthy and growing. And I'm going to spend the better part of my time focusing on that positive aspect. But before I get to that positive aspect, we must also understand something that kind of comes from a negative perspective. We must understand that where potential exists for health and growth, there also exists the potential for non-growth and disease, or as I'm putting it, stunted growth and disease. And this is the reason why the Holy Spirit inspired the Apostle Paul to make such a big deal, make such a big issue out of spiritual health and maturity. Mark it down, truth point number one this morning, where health and maturity, and I'm talking about spiritual health, where spiritual health and maturity fall short, disease and immaturity reign supreme, leading people away from the truth and power of the gospel into a false, damaging religion. When a people of God do not grow, when they do not mature, when they do not possess spiritual health, they find themselves stunted, they find themselves diseased, and they find themselves going off after things that will not help them, that will not encourage them, that will not help them to become more like Christ. They may tickle their ears, they may enlighten their fantasies, but they will not take them where they need to go, to the image of Jesus Christ. Verse 14. Verse 14 says, then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. Again, when health and maturity are in place, then the way verse 14 is written rings true. We won't be those negatives when health and maturity are in place. But when they are not, just the opposite is true. When health and maturity are not in place, then we will be like immature children, and we will be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching, and we will be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. You see, immature children are easily fooled, aren't they? Hello? Immature children are easily fooled. For example, and I'm thinking right now of just immature, young, unlearned, young children. You get some young children like that together, and you take a dirty, tattered, wrinkled, I mean just really it's just very worn out, ugly looking, not very nice, $100 bill. And you take a shiny, brand new, gleaming 50 cent piece. And you show those two to the immature little children. And I venture to say that every single time they will be attracted to the shiny, new 50 cent piece, and they would rather have that than the tattered, dirty, worn out, ugly $100 bill, even though that 50%, that 50 cent piece is 99.5% less valuable than the old $100 bill. You see, they're fooled. They're tricked by the new shiny coin. Its appearance of beauty says to their minds that are yet unlearned and untrained that it has greater value because of its apparent beauty. But the fact is it has very little value at all. On the other hand, you take that same shiny, brilliant 50 cent piece and that dirty, old, tattered $100 bill and you present it to people who are mature, and every single time they will grab that dirty, tattered, old $100 bill because they know it has way more value. Now, as it is in the physical world, so it is in the spiritual. And that's why the health and wealth hucksters are able to live in mansions, wear $2,500 suits, and fly in multi-million dollar airplanes. The new teaching that comes from many of that type that gets pummeled upon the immature, that new teaching seems more thrilling, seems more sexy, seems more shiny. The thought that if you will sow your best financial seed into my ministry, that God will open the windows of heaven upon you and pour out 100-fold return. Wow, who doesn't want that? I sow 1,000, I get what? I sow 100, I get what? Have we not heard that promise made? To those who cannot discern truth from lies, that sounds too good not to be true. And why not? Because it was told to me by an exciting, vibrant, articulate man of God. So it must be right. A few years ago, a false teacher in California convinced many, despite the fact that the Word of God says to the contrary, that he had discovered the exact date of the second coming of Christ. And spiritually immature, unhealthy people were sucked in. I remember as the date was coming, like 2020, and those kind of shows did a couple of newscasts about it. And they showed families where the husband and wife, because they were sucked into this lie, quit their jobs. Some of them talked about how they had gone out and just loaded up their credit cards because the rapture's coming, right? I'll never have to pay. One family spoke specifically about how they had emptied out their bank account and their 401k, and they sold their home and bought a motor home and put, you know, turn or burn, the rapture's coming, traveled the country to preach the gospel so that everybody could be saved because the end is coming. And the day came and went. And another day came and went. And another day came and went. And another month and another year. And that false prophet is now dead. And here we are. And many of those people who got sucked into that because they were not spiritually healthy, they were not spiritually mature, their lives were ruined. As Paul says, they were tossed and blown about by a new wind of doctrine. The lies they believed sounded so much like the truth. But those lies they heard were not the truth. And so the spiritual landscape in our world and in our country is littered with spiritual corpses of people who followed after the lie, the half-truth, the fable, the myth, only to find themselves empty and their faith shipwrecked by spiritual disease and stunted growth, or even worse, coming to a place where they had no faith at all. You know, there's an old saying, I'm about to go positive on you in just a second. There's an old saying that says, what you don't know can't hurt you. How many of you have heard that? How many of you have heard that? I know you've heard it. Now, how many of you have said it? But that's a lie. That is a lie. What you don't know can kill you. And what you don't know in the spiritual realm can cause those who look to you because you're a person of influence, grandpa and grandma, dad and mom, youth leader, deacon, elder, follower of Christ, it can cause others to be led to death as well because they follow you. And so what is the answer? Well, the answer is we need to be spiritually healthy. We need to be spiritually mature. We need to understand that the key to this whole thing is having that knowledge that God has revealed and imparted to us so that we can know the path to walk on, so that we can know the steps to tread in, so that we know how we can actually follow Jesus because we can see the steps that Jesus walked in. Now, Paul tells us that God has given to his church certain gifts. And these gifts are given to aid believers toward spiritual health and maturity. Notice with me verses 11 and 12. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. He gave the apostles and the prophets. He gave the evangelists and the pastors and teachers. And why did he give them? And what is their task? Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and to build up the church, the body of Christ. Let's break these gifts down very quickly. We don't have a lot of time, but let's begin with the apostles and the prophets. I don't want to go too deep in the weeds here, but for now, simply think of the apostles and prophets as those whom God used to lay the foundation of Christian doctrine and first generation teachings on that doctrine. The apostles and the prophets were given to lay the foundation and to give us a good, broad understanding of what that foundation is all about, and that has been laid down in a written record so that other generations would be able to benefit and profit from it and grow spiritually from the revelations that God had given to them. The apostles, in general form, worked on the broader scale. They kind of had the universal church in mind, and they're looking at the whole of Christendom. The New Testament prophets worked more on a localized scale with specific churches. The Apostle Paul is actually referenced in the Bible. I didn't give you those references, but I could if you wanted them. He's actually referenced as both an apostle and a New Testament prophet, as we find him actually ministering in both contexts. But very importantly, in his apostolic office, Paul received new revelation from God. Revelation concerning the plan of redemption. Revelation about how it works. In fact, when we get into the book of Ephesians, basically, in that first half, it's like you're pulling back the curtain and God is saying, let me show you how this really works behind the scenes where you couldn't possibly see or know if I didn't show you. He gave that to Paul. He gave him revelation about where this redemptive plan came from and what its intended end goal is. Paul wrote 13 epistles. That word epistle is just a fancy letter, a word for letters. He wrote 13 letters. We call them books, but they're really letters. And these letters contain revelation. Along with the other epistles written by fellow apostles like Peter and James and John, they serve as the foundation upon which spiritual health and Christian maturity are advanced. So you're already beginning to see that if we're going to be spiritually healthy and mature believers, then we're going to have to be people of the Word, because that was what is given for our spiritual nourishment. Of course, it all goes back to Christ, who the Bible says is the chief cornerstone of the whole thing. Let me read that to you. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, who are built, the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself, or Christ Jesus himself, being the cornerstone. Now, with the foundation of truth laid down by the gift of the apostles and prophets, we now see the addition of evangelists, pastors, and teachers, who are tasked to build on top of that foundation a spiritually healthy, maturing body of Christ followers. Evangelists. Evangelists are those who are uniquely gifted to make known the saving power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, it is every believer's responsibility to tell the good news. You may not actually have the gift of evangelism. That doesn't let you off the hook. You still are supposed to be communicating the good news that has come into your life. But there are some people, both men and women, who receive that special spiritual anointing, and they just have seemingly this ability to articulate the gospel and to see new babies born into the kingdom and family of God. That's what is being talked about here. Dr. Kent Hughes calls them the obstetricians of the church, because they are the ones who are there bringing forth and seeing that life come to be, leading people to faith, saving faith in Christ, delivering those newborn babies. Pastors and teachers. Actually, even though it looks like those are two separate things, that if you get into the original language, which I'm not going to bore you with that seminary talk, represent really one and the same gifting. That of shepherding the flock by nurturing, instructing, correcting, protecting, guiding them with the word of God. Dr. Hughes calls these the pediatricians of the church. You got to have those obstetricians, right? You need the pediatricians as well. Those who take that newborn life and ensure that they receive the right spiritual nutrition, they receive the right care, they receive tending that leads them to health and maturity. And that brings me to truth point number two this morning, and that is this, that God's will for every person he saves is that they be spiritually healthy and maturing. God's will for every person he saves. Has he saved you, my friend? You don't have to say anything or do anything. Just look at me for a second. I don't know how many is in here. Almost 500, I'd say, based on the way it looks like. But are you saved? Well, what's God's will for my life, Pastor? What's God's will for my life? Well, I can't tell you what God's will is in every aspect, but this one foundational aspect I can tell you. God's will is that you be spiritually healthy and growing to maturity to be like Christ. And if you are in a state of ill health or in a state of non-growth, then that is an oxymoron to what God has intended for you. You're not in a good spot. You are not to have someone lay their hand on your forehead and say, bless you. You're right where you need to be. No, you're not where you need to be. We got to find a way to shake off the barnacles. We got to find a way to get you out of the lethargy and the apathy that has overtaken you and get some of that sin that has just kind of crusted over your heart and get you back to a place where you're beating, your heart is beating for Christ. And the thrill of the Spirit of God is coming back alive again. And the Word of God is not a boring old ancient book that means nothing, but all of a sudden becomes an alive text that is thrilling you and you can't wait till the next morning to get back into it again. Because it's bringing life and it's bringing vitality. God's will for every person that he saves is that they be spiritually healthy and maturing. Let's go through the passage to see that. I mean, let's get it out of the Word. Don't just take it from me. Verse 12. The ministry of the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers is to do what? To equip God's people. The word equip comes from the Greek katartismos, which refers to that which is fit, restored to its original condition, made complete. That word that I butchered when I tried to say it in the Greek is used as a medical term for the setting of a broken bone. To return it back to its place of health. So when you see that the apostles and the prophets and the evangelists and the pastors and teachers are there to equip God's people, it's not like we're going to equip you with tools. In particular, it's that we're going to equip you to become healthy so that you have stamina and strength spiritually to serve your master and king and to do great things in his name. Verse 13 speaks of believers in the unity of faith and knowledge of Jesus. To what end? To what end? To the end of becoming mature in the Lord. Verse 14 comes at us from the negative side, leaving immature, childlike characteristics behind so that we can be mature. Verse 15 talks about growing, maturing toward the likeness of Christ. Verse 16 talks about the body is fit together perfectly. And if you go back to 1 Corinthians 12, which was originally what I was going to preach from, but God changed my mind on that. You find that illustration of how we in the body of Christ are like the human body, made up of many differing parts with differing purposes and differing gifts and abilities, yet we come together unified as one body, fit together. You know, my little fingernails here are fit in just the right spot to do just the right thing. And my eyes are fit into my head at just the right spot so that they can perform their function properly. Right, even the hair on my head which some of you have let go of. Thought you didn't need it. I don't know. Maybe you just don't like hair. I don't know. But anyway, is perfectly fit and groomed to make me a handsome man. You think that's funny, Sonny? You think that's funny, don't you? Okay. Well, but you see, all the parts have different functions, heart, lungs, even the hairs in my nose that I now have to trim because I'm over 50. You guys, I'm telling you, it's coming. There'll come a day you'll stand in front of your mirror and you will cut the nose hairs out of your nose and trim the hair off your ears. All right, you see your old dad doing that all the time. Or that, or he's a bushy fella, one of the two. It's all fit together. That speaks of health. Each part, verse 16, doing its own special work. That speaks of health. Each part helping the other parts to grow. Whoa, hey, stop. Look, it's not just about you doing, you getting yours. It's about you making sure others get theirs. Hey, are you hearing me? See, we come to church to get ours. And then we hightail it out the back door because we got to still go get ours at the local buffet. No. It is about you getting yours, but it's about you making sure that others get theirs. This is about mutual two-lane ministry, right? And that's what's been so awesome about my falling apart is, man, you guys stepped up and you did great two-lane ministry, man. You ministered to me and my family in a way that is so awesome, I'll never forget it. But that's the way it's supposed to be amongst us all. Every part. Doing its special work to ensure that the other parts grow. And that results then in the whole body, as it says there in 16, the whole body is healthy, the whole body is growing, and the whole body is full of love. Right, Jacob? That's Jacob's favorite word, love. It's full of love. That's right. Every place you turn in this passage that I've read to you today, the emphasis is on the child of God developing, transforming, becoming healthy and mature. Now here's a key point. Don't miss it. Why is that? Why does this passage hammer on those to such a degree? The answer is because transformation toward the image of Jesus Christ is the reason for saving faith. The idea of saying a prayer to get your ticket and then hanging out until you die or the rapture happens, that teaching or that thought process is as foreign to the Bible as idol worship. God's intent for every person that he saves, every person that he touches with saving grace, is to systematically transform them to be more and more like his perfect son, Jesus. Therefore, in our hearts who have been touched by saving grace, the greatest desire of our hearts should be that we be conformed by the Spirit of God and by the Word of God to be more and more like Jesus. Well, spiritual health and Christian maturity are key to walking as disciples of Jesus Christ. Since they are key to discipleship, they must be key initiatives in this local church. Pastor John Calvig is one on staff who has been tasked to lead us in that realm. You will be hearing in days to come about initiatives for men, initiatives for women, initiatives for us together, intergenerationally and so forth, of how we can interact with one another, how we can be part of a small group, life group type ministry, how we will be working together in our worship services and in our small groups and in our going out to put it into practice. So as we move forward into our future, developing discipleship from a variety of angles will be at the very top of our priority list. And just to be clear, I said that twice for emphasis. Just to be clear, that means more than an endless list of classes to take with fill-in-the-blank note guides. That's what we're accustomed to, isn't it? Classes on Sunday morning, classes on Sunday night, classes on Wednesday night, classes, classes, classes. We've been to classes. I'm not making fun of classes. Classes are good. I plan, once we get past this summer of transition, to begin a Wednesday night theology teaching thing, whatever. So if you want to learn the different areas of theology, come and I'll give you my seminary stuff, okay? Yeah, there's a place for that. That's good. But it's more than that. Because we've got people who are classed out. They have got notebooks and note guides and leader guides and study guides all through their house, and they are no more mature than the kid who grabs the 50-cent piece. You see, there's a step that's been missing. And that step is an intentional, thought-out, planned way of taking what you're learning in here and making it come out into the way that you're approaching your community and your life out there. Because it's not until you start applying what you've taken in up here, it's not until you do that that you can actually say, I've learned something. Am I right, teacher? Ernie, welcome back from Arizona. Ernie was a teacher. You're a retired teacher. Now a professional bike rider. This kind of bike. I mean, what good is it for your story? What did you teach in school?
Science.
What kind of science? Just science. Okay, I got you. Just general, run-of-the-mill science. But the point is, what good is it for your students to just learn a bunch of theories and just hold them in their heads? Would we have ever gotten to the moon that way? Would we ever cure any diseases that way? Would we have built highways all over our nation that way? No. It takes applying what you learn. And when you apply it, then you've actually learned it, and then you're benefiting not only yourself, but you're benefiting others. Amen? Am I communicating this morning in a way that we can grasp this? See, that's what we've got to become as a church. Not just interested in gathering to fill in the blank, but filling in the blank so that on Tuesday, when X thing comes up, I've got an idea of what I might actually be able to do to represent Jesus, my King, and His kingdom. And then on the next Sunday, I bring my little sheep that I have influenced back with me to be introduced to the other sheeps so that we can all grow together. You're not impressed. So in that vein, I gotta end this thing. So in that vein, Pastor John brought me, knowing what we were going to be speaking on today, he brought me this spiritual growth assessment. Yeah. Now he didn't create it, he stole it from Lifeway. But anyway, no, he just borrowed it, yeah. Anyway, so, but we've got like 400 of these at the exits on your way out. And you know, I've been talking about spiritual health and maturity. My question is, where are you at on the continuum? Now, we'd all like to say that we're robust and healthy. But it's highly likely that for all of us, there's some places where we're strong and some places where we're not so strong. Well, a spiritual growth assessment like this can go a long way in helping us to discover some of those things. So here's what I want you to do. I encourage you. We have enough for everybody, right? Take one. 30 minutes of your time to read through the questions and consider carefully what's being asked. Like there are sections here about abiding in Christ and living in the Word and praying in faith and fellowship with believers and witness to the world and ministering to others and a variety of questions, about 10 questions, each one of those that you can take and score. And if nothing else, you see where you're doing kind of good and you see where you're kind of weak, and it gives you an idea of what you might be needing to pursue to catch up or to get where you want to be or where you need to be. So take one of these on your way out. Do you have to turn it in? Do you have to give us your score? Absolutely not. This is just for you. Use it. See what the Holy Spirit reveals. Secondly, connection cards. That perforated thing on your bulletin, if you didn't get the opportunity to fill that out before the offering plates went by, and you have a prayer request, or a praise, or a question, or a comment, fill it out, and when you're going out the doors, walk up to the connection box and drop it in, all right? And we will pray and rejoice and try to answer questions if you have them. And finally, as always, Connie and I are here at the front as we dismiss to be available to you, to pray with you. Perhaps there's a need in your life and you just need someone to talk to and have prayer with. That's what we're here for. Or maybe you've been sensing the Spirit of God pulling at your heart about following Jesus. But there's a couple of crucial questions that you have. Come and ask. Give us the opportunity to help you see God's love for you and how you can have an intimate, vibrant, alive relationship with His Son, who is our Savior and our Lord. So, Father, I pray that you'll take the things that have been shared today and that you'll awaken us as a people about the importance of spiritual health and Christian maturity. I can't imagine a single person who claims the name of Christ who would want to be a baby their whole life. It's okay for the newborns to be newborns, but for the 10-year-olds and the 20-year-olds and the 30-year-olds, it is unthinkable that we would be babies. But Lord, if we are, may we accept that. That would be the first step of growth. I've allowed myself to be a baby. Time to grow up. First step toward maturity. And there are tools, and there are circumstances, and there are people available, Lord. So convince them. Help them to see their need and to take steps that will enable them to grow. And for those who have yet to come to faith in Jesus, I pray that today would be the day. May they not be afraid, but may they come and share their heart, that we may share your heart with them. Bless this body of believers. Again, I ask you to bless the 90s. I ask you to bless the Stephases. We've enjoyed their presence, but now you take them, you use them as you see fit. May we rejoice in the good things you do in their lives in the days to come. I offer this prayer to you in Jesus' name. Amen.